The upper room, yeah! We are now live in the upper room. I am your host, King Cleve, along with my co-host, Zeke the 5 Foot Freak, and the legend that is Larry. We are back by popular demand. And before we jump into today's show, of course, we got to give the legend his due and let him tell you what gives him
the red ass.
Well, fellas, it's Christmas time, and you know, I think during this time you kind of see more, not that there's more homeless people, but you know, I guess it's more noticeable because it's the time of year of sharing and giving, and you see the beggars on the corner, and you know, I'll be feeling some type of way about it, you know, because I'm truly blessed. I really am. And but, you know, you can argue that some of them may be hustling. You know, you may see them, they're in good physical shape. And people be like, well, you know what? They can go and work. You know, it's not like they're handicapped. You know, my thing is, hey, that's a good argument. I don't have time to try to think about that. As I'm driving up, I got 30 seconds to a minute before the light turned green. So my thing is, my heart is saying, hey, man, go help them people out. And some of them out there with kids. You know, they got the whole family out there. Like, come on, man. I'm not about to take that chance and wonder, oh, they're getting over on me on $2 or $3. I go ahead and give it to them. But, you know, there are also dangers of letting people come to your car. You know, you got the kidnapping going on. You got robbers. So, you know, I think a lot more people are skeptical of even giving. But I say that to say this, what gives me the red ass, Otis, is that when I come up on a corner and I see these athletic teams, these kids on the corner begging for money, I have a problem with that. Especially when I see the coach with his lazy ass sitting down in some lawn chair with a Big Gulp sipping. I have a problem with that. You know, my thing is, you know, first of all, there are fundraisers you can do. You're in an organization. Get your parents involved. Stop taking the money from the entry fees and going to buy PlayStations and iPhones, you know. And so, but you see these kids on these corners. It's dangerous, number one, you know. And my thing is, like, okay, I know before the season starts, you have a budget. You've already planned this. Why after at the end, and you know, I gave the money to them because, you know, I'm like, you know what, man, obviously they need it. I refuse to believe that these people are having these kids out here, but I look at it as poor planning, and also, yeah, you cannot tell me that you did not plan for this or you didn't know that you was going to be struggling or whatever. For you to put them kids out in harm's way, I just feel like it's irresponsible. It's ridiculous, and it's just a poor showing on the leadership of that organization. And that just really just pisses me off, man. It really do. And I know, like, people say, hey, man, you know, team struggle, not everybody got the money. There are other ways that you can do that. There are other ways. That is not the only way. But, again, on top of all that, even if it's legit, you got the head coach, all the adults chilling, while everybody walking around with football helmets on the corner. Cars flying by 50 miles an hour. Come on, man. You're talking about 10, 11, 12-year-old kids. So I just feel like that's an issue that needs to be addressed. I don't know what. As AAU coaches and select coaches that y'all been, how y'all feel about that?
So now I can weigh in on that?
Oh, you could have been weighed in, but no, I'm going to keep going.
All right. Well, first off, I agree with you entirely on everything that you said, but every organization is not the same. I know we did water bottle fundraisers. We sat at the ferry one time in Galveston, and when they had backup during the summertime, we handed out bottles of water for donations. Yes, there's a lot of other fundraisers out there that people can do, but mainly some of the ones are at Walmart because Walmart is one of the biggest store changes in America.
Right.
with the coaches sitting down, I'm not speaking for all coaches. I think that's the way of showing the kids that, hey, you have to get out and work, and sometimes you may have to do things like this to raise money for your organization. Mm-hmm. Now, with you saying that planning, you plan ahead of time for tournaments, that is true, but sometimes things come up because tournament fees can change. Mm-hmm. Travel plans can change. It may be a situation where one kid probably don't have enough money to be involved in a tournament, and they probably doing a fundraiser for that particular player on their team. So it's a lot of different things that probably can go on with fundraising and different reasons behind it.
Let me interject though. Okay, and I hear what you're saying, but you know what I see more? I see a lot of female organizations, baseball teams, volleyball, whatever, what have you. They're out there doing car washes. I have yet to see any male organizations, male teams get out there and do car washes.
Okay.
Again, that's a lot more work than coming up to each car and getting some money, but I'm just saying.
All right, well now let's talk about car washes. Like you said, with everything going on, if my female daughter was out there doing car washes, now I'm worrying about pedophiles if she's getting wet. What are you looking at?
That's extreme.
I'm just saying.
I hear what you're saying. Yeah. I mean, in this culture, in this climate,
we got to
think of that. Okay.
So I'd rather stay at the Walmart, pass out the helmet, or stay at the Walmart, use your glove to get money.
My point of saying that, though, Freak, was that it looked like they're putting in more work than the boy organizations. Now, yeah, I mean, if you want to.
Let me say this.
Go ahead.
And I've been listening. Let me say this.
You heard enough?
I don't agree with them having a running in and out between the cars. Mm-hmm. And that's very dangerous.
I
can sit here and say that I've only almost hit a child like that before. So I think that that's very dangerous. Now, the fundraising, for one, you need to have a team together, have it organized before anything even starts. And be like, okay, we're going to this tournament. Okay, let's get the fees in order. Okay, boom. Let's say that we have to get rooms. If it's a team that travels, we're gonna need plane tickets. Mm-hmm. We're gonna have to feed these food. So we have to beforehand get a budget. Mm-hmm. Right. So now we get a budget. And let's just say that the budget for the whole team for the whole sum is $50,000. Right?
Okay.
All right. So this is what we're going to do. We're going to fundraise. Right? And we're going to start this before the season ends.
So the fees is not going to cover the budget.
Anything can come up.
But fees aren't going to cover. And this is what I'm saying. So we're going to fundraise whatever we can get, okay? And let's just say that we do $50,000, right, is the budget. So let's just say we fundraise and we can come up with $20,000. Mm-hmm. We try to find a couple of sponsors, and we find another 10. So now we at 30. That $20,000, let's take that and divide that in between the players. And when I say the players, the fees.
Okay, so it reduces the cost.
It reduces the cost. And then that's the best way to do that, even though that not everyone does
it. Like I said, King, not everybody is as forthcoming and organized as you.
Well, I did it for a long time, and we did it several different ways, and I just found out that was the best way to do it. That way you don't spring stuff, because you got parents, and I don't care how well off a parent is, unless it's that Puff Daddy or somebody who, you know, you come and say, oh, well, we're going to need $3,000 for this by next week.
Yeah.
You can't
break that bread off.
You don't do that.
Yeah.
Okay. But, yeah. Well, with that being said, we're going to go to break. It seems Legend had a real red ass today. And we run a little longer than normal, so we're going to go to break, and then we'll be right back. All right, we back now live in the upper room. America, we still here.
King, I just thought about something.
What's that?
Where's the black Trump supporter, man?
He didn't get back to me, so evidently he had to work, man. But we're going to get him in there.
He had to work or he's running.
and no, the man had to
no,
work.
No, let me tell you. He actually came to me and suggested.
He wants some of us.
He want this smoke.
We're gonna give it to him.
So we're gonna see, but yeah. So
I wish Mr. Edward Benjamin, A.K.A. Pepper, would call in because he say he's not a supporter of Trump, but he support Trump being in office because it helps him in the offshore field.
Really? No, because of the oil companies.
Yes.
Right. Because Trump was a big supporter of the Exxons and your Valeros. Big business, big money.
Right.
Got Pepper to call in.
Got something for him, huh?
Yeah.
I think our studio, can you think you can get him online?
No.
No, she's busy.
So, I mean, whatever. With that being said, man, we had to continue on from last week. There's a lot that we didn't get to cover, or I ain't gonna say that we didn't get to cover, but we didn't finish covering. I think we spent enough on Trump, enough time on Trump.
There's
never enough time.
But.
But now we might, you know.
Oh, we're gonna get back on.
Okay, so, but with that being said, let's go back and tackle again the whole sex trafficking / kidnapping that's going on. Because, you know, it's huge, man. We all have females in our family.
Right? I told you I was going to do that training with my daughters. Mm-hmm. And I was doing some research after I got YouTube certified to be a pepper spray expert. And what I learned, freak, is that one of the things, and this is for you, Mrs. Brown, too, and all the females out there, because the females are pretty much guilty for this. They like to sit in their cars and be on the phone.
Oh, speak on it.
Facebook.
Can you say that again? Just say that one more time.
Females, you know, specifically I'm talking about the gender of females, not males. They like to sit in their cars, whether they just coming from the store or whatever. And of course, for whatever reason, they can't just turn the car on and go. So they got to take 10 minutes, 15 minutes to check out who texting or whatever on social media, whatever. You become a target.
Easy target.
Because they sitting there, they waiting, they watching, and they plotting. They said, don't do that. Once you get in your car, lock the doors, and go. This is from the FBI.
You know something that's strange, too? If you take the average person and ask them, especially if they have vehicles as tenant, when they walk to their car, the first thing they do is open up the door. They never look in the back seat.
Could be somebody writing. Yeah, it's real, man. There's a couple of other situations and scenarios that I researched too. And I tell you what, man, let me go ahead and look that up while y'all go ahead and conversate about it.
It's funny, last night, you know, I was out with some family and friends at Maduro's, one of our podcast spot, and I was talking to my my cousin, Weenie Dog, and he was saying that, you know, now it's so bad that, like, with his wife, she'll come home and then leave, like, to go to the store, go shopping. And by this time, you know, it's like nighttime or whatever the case may be. And it's so bad now that he have to tell his wife, like, come home. Like, you don't need to be out.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Those days of just taking for granted that, oh, they just run into the store every second count. And it's making us more paranoid, you know, as a people, really.
Right.
I mean, you know, and, you know, I'm not saying that can cause issues in a relationship, but, you know, back in the day, if you really picking on your spouse about, well, you've been 5 minutes, where you at, blah, 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 because you paranoid that they're doing something. No, it's really about your safety now. Mm-hmm. It ain't about me just saying you was with such and such or what you've been doing for the past 6 minutes and 30 seconds.
And ladies, you have to understand that we're not saying that we are more stronger or more able to defend ourselves than you. It's just that you are more vulnerable of being attacked than a man. I don't think they want to kidnap a man.
You got time for all that wrestling, man. That's going to be, right. They're trying to get them in that van.
Right.
Man, I saw a van on the highway with that lock on. You remember, the lock that they talked about?
Lock.
Man, I was trying to follow him, but he was gone, bro.
Now, why would you follow the van?
Because I wanted to get the address and call it in, man. Hey, man.
You never know what you could have prevented.
Yeah, man.
It could have been a business van, though.
It could, but see, in this day and time, I don't care. Because, you know what I'm saying?
The same
it was a white van, and it had that big old round lock on the back door, man.
What were the windows like?
No windows. The only windows was on the passenger and the driver.
Drop side.
That's it. It was one of those vans, man. It was one of those vans. But,
what up, Wayne Dog? I see you looking.
Man, we definitely have to change up the way that we move. You need to call, check, and it not only affects them, but it affects us because now it pulls you out of your comfort zone, and let's just say you know. Been at work all day, have a long day, you want to sit down and watch the game.
Right.
Yeah, it is. I want to go to the store. So guess what? Now you got to get them and go to the store too.
No doubt.
And that's
you want that peace of mind?
That's just what it is.
You want that peace of mind? Hey, I got some more rules, mm-hmm. King. Do not be on your cell phone leaving the mall when you're leaving a store. Whenever you're going to your car, going through that parking lot, be vigilant. Be aware. Look for anything suspicious. Get off the cell phone. Another thing, lock your doors as soon as you get into the car. That's another situation where as soon as you get in, that's a vulnerable situation because you're trying to get prepared, putting bags down, whatever. Bam, they're coming.
Reaching through your purse looking for your phone.
Right? Yeah.
You should have your keys when you walk out. But another big thing that some people, no one thinks about, and this is one of my things that I yell about, when you leave in the morning, afternoon, whenever it is you leave, because people are now getting grabbed during the day, if you're leaving at night, if you're coming home at night. When you pull, and see, this gives a false sense of security because people are like, oh, well, I got to grow watch. If you pull in, you don't put that door down before you get out that car. You see, or if you walk out your house, the first thing you do is hit the garage door and open up before you get in your car.
Yeah, that thing
so get in
like
your car first, lock the door, and open up the garage.
Yeah, you don't have to start it, but make sure you're in the car and then open your garage.
I like that.
And go.
King.
That's something that, you know, I prepare because I'm walking out there. If I'm here, I'm going out
so
there
too.
So
this ain't nothing that you researched. This is the king.
No, that's just me.
So you can take credit for that.
Well, whatever.
That's all right there, man. Let me get one while I got YouTube certified in.
Before you go, for our viewers that's watching in now, you can tune in at any time. We'd like to hear your opinion, your views, and the things that you may do to help secure yourself when you leaving home, work, your wife, your kids, or whatever the case may be. Go ahead, lady.
Another thing that you can do, ladies and gentlemen, you can lie to the attacker. And tell them you have been microchipped and I can be easily traced. Hey, man, you know.
Are people getting microchipped?
Yeah. But I'm just saying that it doesn't hurt. It doesn't hurt to try that. They, just by saying that, they may let you go.
I have a question.
Yeah, go ahead.
With the microchip, that's a good deal, but don't a lot of phones have... like tracking family.
They gonna throw that phone.
Yeah, that's the first thing they're gonna get rid of, man. Any device like that. And also they say if you're in the trunk, they do get you in the trunk.
You got a trunk with you.
But they probably take it out. Please? But they probably take it out. In your own trunk? Or they trunk?
Whatever trunk. If you were in a car, you can kick out the taillight.
Oh, I heard about that.
Yeah. Kick out the taillight, two things can possibly happen. The police will pull you over. Hopefully.
Or you can put your hand outside. I know about that.
Yes.
But with the trunk release, if I'm pretty sure a lot are not giving them ideas, I'm pretty sure they already pull that card out, so you can't pull the trunk release.
These guys may not be that bright. I don't know if they're going to cover all that. They so money hungry. Again, a lot of these people that's that's kidnapping these people.
They just had a girl get out through the trunk.
These ain't the brightest, you know, so criminals.
She hurt herself because she jumped out when the car was moving, but she ain't alive.
So I really think a lot of these different tactics can help people because, again, the profile of these people that's kidnapping these women, again, these are people who are desperate, you know, they trying to make a dollar. And so anyway, just throw that out there for the safety and for the men's too, you know, and not just for women. I think that, you know, if I'm a kidnapper, if I see a man that's, you know, not really on the manly side, I may take a shot at him, you know, so it may not be just all women.
I don't want to sell arms on the black market, huh?
Yeah.
Right, you never know.
Yeah.
You know, maybe it might get sold into sex trade.
Yeah, anything can happen, man.
But, you know, seriously, it's just got to the point, man, where it's just ridiculous.
Yeah. Look at what we discussed.
I was...
Right.
I was in a store yesterday, the day before my daughter. And I guarantee she wasn't 3 feet from me. She was, I mean, not even. Well, another little girl walked in between us. You know, when toys say she walked in between. And for like a fraction of a second, I couldn't, you know, she just, I mean, it was just like passing.
Right.
And I went ballistic. And
Because you lost view of her.
You
just like that.
Do not leave from by my side. And that's just what it is.
People laugh at people. Y'all know the little harnesses that they put on kids so the kids won't run off? You know, a lot of people complain. I know.
I don't like that.
I know you don't. I did it with one of my kids. One of my kids just didn't, you know, it's out of control, okay? So I did it. Mm. Yeah, I put it on.
I don't like that.
Yeah. But.
I mean, hey, to each his own, that's your kid.
Right.
My niece, nephew, whichever one it was.
Right.
Hey, I'm for you because I hate to see it as one of my family members because I already know how I am.
Yeah.
But.
I mean, it was a good animal. It was cute. That makes a difference. I mean, it wasn't like I didn't have her on a leash, a dog leash or a chain. Right.
See, that's what I'm thinking, a dog leash.
No, man. Not a good animal or whatever.
A good animal?
Yeah.
What the hell is a good animal?
You don't remember good animals, man?
No.
Man, you know, we were some of the worst dressed people. Good animals is a. It's like a style of clothing.
It's a shirt, right?
Right, but they got animals on them.
Oh, they call them garamals?
They call them garamals,
man. I'm pretty sure I had that one.
I think it was like a hippo or some shit.
This dude say a garamal.
But no, seriously, man. You know, that's just something. I mean, it seems like the numbers that they give you that, oh, it's been so many. But then every day you turn on, man, it's just, this person's been kidnapped. That person's been kidnapped.
But King, back to that example, that situation you brought up on how that you lost view of your daughter for like half a second.
No, it even half a second.
It don't. But that's all it takes.
Yeah.
And because I don't know if y'all seen the show on Facebook. They be having these videos of these kidnappers. The woman, the girl is right behind the mama. The mama is looking at some clothes, and they just come and just grab them and put their hand over her.
I saw one that the mother was like walking in the store. As soon as she walked in the store with her baby, and they took the one from behind
them. Yeah. And that's why when we walk in, we hand in hand.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Oh, it's so real, y'all.
Oh, yeah.
It's so real.
And, you know, I make sure everywhere that I go.
I don't know how those parents deal with it, y'all.
Think
about it, dude. It's, to me, it'd be better if I knew they were dead. But the fact that I don't know and what they're experiencing.
I agree. Because if somebody was ever grab mine and run out, I'm shooting. And I take that chance because I feel, and I hate to put it like this, the deaf are being better and far better than what they're going to be put through.
Yep.
You know, and that's just what it is. Yep.
They become sex slaves for the rest of their life until they die.
Yeah.
Until they can't take no more drugs.
Or until they found, if ever found.
Yeah.
And then if they found, they so mentally scarred.
But just imagine. Well,
think about the little girl. How old was she? If she was in the sex thing, she was rescued. She went on back to her family. And later, she committed suicide because of
it. But what about a couple of years ago when they made all the memes about the black guy that rescued the girl from the white family? Remember back then, they was making all the memes about him, but she was with them like for 12 or 13 years. He raped her. She had kids by him. And she came to the screen door, and he got out the screen door.
I remember that, man.
But look, stuff like that, you know?
When I put myself in the mindset of the children, the first thing I think about as they're kidnapped, as they're in this van, as they're in this place, and they are crying out for mama and daddy. And that's it. It's over with. Man, that's real, man.
Yeah.
That is so real.
Like that cop said, once they get you, you might as well be on Mars. Because there is no way to, you know, they have nowhere knowing where you're at.
I will lose it, y'all. I'm not going to lie.
I'm with you.
I'm not going to lie. We can sit up here and be like, well, life go on. Mm-hmm.
That's nah, I can't go on. That's your child.
I will lose it, y'all. I know where it will send me. And, you know, I know we all go through tests in life. And I'm not saying, hey, there are thousands of parents that's dealing with the exact thing that we're talking about. And, life go on. They have to go to work. But, my God, man, that's the worst nightmare. And like the king was saying, I would rather death.
Right.
I would rather death. You know, I get some closure on it. She's not going through anything, mental, physically. Hey, you know, I lost my child. But to know I lost my child is still out there suffering, and I can't do nothing about it.
Yeah,
bro.
Yeah, it's a tough situation. I don't think any parent ever wants to go through, and because then even after all that, you still questioning yourself, what could I have done?
That's it.
You know, and you think about people, and you see them, and I seen once, and it has nothing to do with this, but this father, he was supposed to be watching his son. He was cooking something outside on the grill. He was going inside, you know, went inside, taking the little boy stayed outside. Kind of got caught up for a few minutes.
Yeah.
Went back outside, and the boy was in the pool.
In the pool?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, the kid just jumped in there.
Well, he had fell or whatever. He got him, tried to revive him. Couldn't revive him. Called paramedics, they came.
Gone.
And he killed himself.
Whoa.
Can't judge him though.
And you know.
Can't judge him.
He killed himself because of the grief. All right, we taking callers at any time, man. I got if you look up I just posted the link if you want to call in. I also actually place it down where, I don't know if you can just click on that while it's on the screen, but I put it in the comments section where you can just click on if you want to come on and give us your 2 cents. You know, we definitely have a lot to say, and I know that this is, you know, it's
a sensitive subject.
It is.
It's a sensitive subject.
It is.
Especially
it
if you got kids. If you don't have kids.
Thank you for bailing me out. But
nephews, because it's real, bro.
So, with that being said, we're going to step away for a minute, and then we'll be back. But before I do that, let me say this. we go ahead and do this because I'm a man. We give a shout out to the Cowboy Nation. Because I'm always riding them when they lose.
Okay.
So I know they pretty much got this one wrapped up. I guess the game's still on. Mm-hmm. But Isaac Benefield, Mark Tyler, Kerry Bell, John Ralph, Sean Christian, you know, all the rest of you, my mother-in-law, all the rest of you Cowboy fam, give you a shout out. Y'all handed to our business.
Uncle Kerry.
Malcolm Moore.
See
Eddie Scott. Caldwell.
Yeah.
See Scott. Now, hey, congratulations, man. But
I don't want to hear nothing about no damn Super Bowl yet. But, make the playoffs.
But you're leaving a team out, too. They did pretty good today.
Well, I mean, we don't.
I mean, you got to give it a
Texan fans,
Rodney Smith.
Texan fans are classy fans.
All right, with that being said, we're going to go to a break and let them have that conversation off air. Back live up the room.
King, before you take it to another direction, I just want to share this Uber story. As y'all know, I Uber. But recently, I want to say in the past several weeks, there was a situation where Uber drivers were picking up riders and they were in cahoots with the kidnappers.
I seen it.
That right there. How do you avoid that? Because, I mean, a lot of my Uber riders now, they look at the license plate, they look at my face, you know, they're checking out the vehicle, because there's a lot of things you can do on the Uber rider app that can confirm that, okay, this is the right person. I'm assuming that when that person got into that car, that wasn't the real Uber driver. Because if he was the real Uber driver, we got a real serious situation.
You talking about that guy that killed that college girl?
Right. I'm assuming that he was just faking to be one. And like I tell my Uber drivers, because now when they come into my car, I mean, they're really checking me out. And I'm like, you know, I show them my ID. I help them out. I don't have no attitude because I was like, I understand. I would do the same thing.
Well, maybe more Uber drivers need to be like you.
No, I'm one of the best. But that's besides the point. I'm at a platinum level. That's the highest that you can be.
Right.
If you go and check out all my credits and everything, I mean, for the past 2 years, man, nothing but high marks. I am one of the best Uber drivers. Also, I have a...
Yeah, the little bottles of wine and water.
No. I have a little water, a little small little water that I get. I also have a transportation company if you need to go to Hobby and or Bush. That's outside of Uber land.
Well, I have a question. Can I ask
you? No, go ahead, man.
All right, first off, with Uber, do they do background checks on the driver?
Yeah.
Do they? Is it an extensive background check or just a little?
They check you out. It's going to take a week. Once you apply, it's going to take you a week. They're going to check out everything, man. And also, too, they do random like face checks. Like when I click on my Uber app, they'll have me take a picture.
Oh, no, sir. I
gotta take it right then and there, bro.
Yep. All right, now let me ask you this. Have there been situations when you pick up customers, majority of them drunk?
No.
Or under influence?
No. It's only like after like 12 o'clock. And I primarily work in Galveston because Galveston's real laid back. Houston, the crazies in Houston, and I stay away from Houston. Now, I've had a few people, you know, do some blow in the back, you know, and... Yeah, then they had nerve to waste it on my carpet.
Did they offer you anything?
Huh? Yeah, of course they offered me, man. I'm like, man, what are you doing, man? I'm driving, man.
If you ever get pulled over and it's a little smear of whatever in your car.
Oh, yeah, I know. Yeah, right. But okay, no, just I didn't know.
Right.
I didn't know until at the end. Mm-hmm. And then while I'm about to get out, then, you know, I'm like, oh, man, these guys, you know, I heard a little something, but I'm focusing on the road. But, yeah, man, I mean, it's like taxi cab confessions. And a lot of things go down.
One last question. I think the boss are like this.
What you got?
Do you happen to market and advertise the upper room when you're giving your customers?
Always, when I'm talking to them, I'm talking about everything that's going on with me, and I always talk about the podcast.
Okay.
So I'm always, it ends up there.
Do you have any video footage of that? I remember you wanted to do a little segment on video. Car confessions, the upper room car confessions could be a great one.
Yeah, no, I ain't got that.
I ain't got that.
I don't have that. But I do talk about the podcast. I have my cards in there, you know, because they always ask me what I do, and I tell them, you know, I coach and everything, but I also have a podcast, so, yeah, you know,
right.
I put it out there. Took a 5 minutes of your time, King. Let's just talk about the Uber situation.
It's all good, man. What I like to do is get a brave soul on that wants to come on and speak. But I think another thing that a problem that we definitely have here in America is how certain people are treated differently. Yeah, I think you know where I'm going with it. When you think about it, America makes up a very small percentage of the people in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Yet and still, when you look at the people that are in prison throughout the world, we have over 25%. And if you want to give it a...
Break it down.
If you want to go even further...
Break it down.
The percentages of minorities, specifically blacks, as opposed to the percentage that we make up in prison. You look at the sentences that are handed out as far as our white contemporaries. I was looking at a show the other day, and where this woman was given 20 years, first offense. So she was a drug dealer.
Mm-hmm.
Don't get me wrong, she was a drug dealer.
Mm-hmm.
She was a big time drug dealer.
Mm-hmm.
20 years. Whereas they looked at the white drug dealers,
mm-hmm,
that would get little slaps on the wrist.
Mm-hmm.
Same show, I seen the woman that called her the tax fraud queen. I don't know if you remember her. A couple years ago,
mm-hmm,
she was stealing Social Security numbers, getting these taxes.
Mm-hmm.
And well, they gave her, oh man, it was like 30 some years.
Yeah, white collar crime.
White collar crime. First offense,
mm-hmm,
well, it wasn't the first offense, but everything else was little minor stuff. And then, you know, remember they had the guy who was on Wall Street who did a lot more damage than what she did.
Right.
He got 7 years. And even, you know, that was one of the things that a lawyer brought up during the sentences. How could you possibly give her this amount of time?
Was it?
No, I take that back. It wasn't 30. It was 31 years. And she appealed the case. They overturned it. The sentence. She came back up. And the same judge asked to be the judge again. So, see, he was a retired judge, so he could pick and choose
what cases he wanted to
try. So he came back up again and told her, I said, that there were 31 years, you getting 31 years. That's 31, no, it might have been 21, because I think they said she was like 26 years old, so she's going to be like 47 when she got out.
If you was to rank all the ethnic groups and the genders, for white male, white woman, Mexican male, Mexican woman, you know, all the way down, Oriental, whatever,
mm-hmm,
Middle Eastern.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I'm not an expert. I haven't done no research. Based on my experience, what I've seen on TV, what I've gone through, I would say black women are at the bottom.
At the bottom of what?
Bottom of the hierarchy as far as being respected on the treatment of society in America. I don't feel like they... I just feel like they are I just feel like they're at the bottom. At the same time, they are, I think, at the top as far as graduating from college. The income is rising. But, you know, when you talk about the treatment, of course, blacks, but then you want, you know, I just like to kind of break it down a little bit to see, because I know black men, we catching it. But I still feel like we get a lot more respect due to what we can do as far as entertainment.
Well, can I weigh in
on that? Yeah, go ahead.
Well, you know, I'm always the guy coming with stats on that, but mm-hmm. The Pew Research Center stated 68% say neither men nor women have it easier today. So the
which
women
mean,
are
you talking about black or men, just men or women?
Black men and black women. Mm. So
nobody's better off.
Right,
because
you said the women are at the bottom. That's no longer true.
That's no longer
according true. To the report. Now I'm pretty sure there's other reports out there, but the Pew Research Center says we both at 68%. Neither one of us are.
Well, that just goes to show that that's another struggle and fight. For so long, women have always been considered the weaker sex, considered to be needy, and so, you know, that's just how we grew up treated, you know. Right. So, and it was always stand behind me instead of standing beside me. So now that they're not going for it, which brings me to the battle, my battle, you know, you got your battle, I got mine, me right. And the feminist.
Right.
So now you got the feminist needing the choice that, okay, you don't need a man. You can do this all by yourself. And
But do you think that that's just a response to how they've been treated in the past, and specifically in the black community from black men?
Well, I think that was the Beyonce movement.
Well, this has been going on for a while.
Well, we just love to jump on the bandwagon.
It's been going on. The feminist movement started in the 70s.
Yes. Yeah. Well, but anything that but now we got social media. They got a wider range, a bigger network, you know, to get into these homes. But so now, and I'm not just speaking on black women. It's every woman.
Well, every woman.
Yeah,
they're
on the.
But it's not all on the same level, though.
No, but so you know so they're teaching that you can get by without a man. You don't need a man. Anything that he can do, you can do
this better.
Yeah, and so now, if you look the rise, like you say, women are now making, you know, the rise of, you know, they're making more money, right. The education is getting, you know, they work harder to achieve what they want. And a lot of times, because with men have always been in that place of control, mm-hmm. So they get stagnant, mm-hmm. And get comfortable.
There you go.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So now, women are surpassing us.
Right.
You know, now you got homes where women are bringing in more money.
More money than the man. More educated.
Yeah, but that's the America that we're living in now. Right. And I can't really sit, because I would never sit and tell anyone or try to stop anyone from bettering themselves.
Right.
You know, because there's a case in point. You know, if she go and, you know, she goes back to grad school, she gets this, she gets that, she gets a better job. Well, I'm out of stepping away, because now that's helping me out. That's less of a load that I have to carry.
But not everybody carry the same mindset either. A lot of men get jealous.
Oh, yeah.
But where they feel that they lose their
iron grip. Control.
Yeah, they lose their control.
Right, and they feel like, well, she won't respect me the same because I'm not the breadwinner.
But
which is, that's a factor.
And I'm going to say, you do have some women.
That's
when they do,
factor.
They do turn
because
that way.
Because women naturally look as a man as the provider and the protector.
I have to provide.
I have to provide more than you no matter what.
What can you tell me?
Right. I'm the one paying this house. I'm the one doing this, blah, blah, blah. At first, it's all good. Like, no, we in this together. But you cannot tell me there's a subtle a subtle disappointment to whereas, well, my man is really not pulling the load that I would love him to be because I want to look at him in a certain light, but that's just the situation we're in. But also too, you know, when I go back to the women, especially black women, having this empowerment movement, the Beyonce movement, the feminist movement, I do think that was a response. I think there needs to be more balance with it. I do think at times it does go overboard, but there's some responsibility that has to go on the black man. Think about this. When you think about music, let's just go to the music part. What other race disrespects their women in music? I'm not saying white women, Mexican women, Middle Eastern women
country out there,
they messing around, you know, doing this. But you don't hear the type of disrespect in their songs the way it is in our songs.
But go even further. I mean, you know, these people don't, they look at it as, oh, I'm just entertaining, but they don't look at the fact of the reach that they have. So, you know, they just had the young guy, the rapper, I can't, what was his name? He just
overdosed.
What was his name?
I forget his name.
Whatever it was.
You know, you remember his name?
But anyway, we have to be held accountable for that. Society has to be, when I say society, that our community, because that's what we're promoting. We're promoting getting high, you know, popping pills and drinking syrup and this and that.
Right.
And it reaches these kids and it has an effect on them. And they want to do, it's just like when they, every time that somebody saw Michael Jordan when we young was soaring through the app, dunking the bomb. Well, you grab your bomb, you want to go outside. You want to be a part of that.
Right.
But, so, go ahead.
But my thing is, like you said with the young man that's OD, what about the friends? Why they can't be held accountable?
Because they probably were doing it too. And so that's what I'm saying. And 9 times out of 10, fools don't roll alone.
Right.
More, they come in pass.
Yeah.
Right. So, you know, the probably was getting high and drinking the syrup with him too.
Yeah.
He just got by this time.
Right.
Yeah. You think about this. Think about this. Anytime you find somebody at an OD or something like that, I guarantee you, he wasn't alone. And if he was alone, when he started doing it, he wasn't alone. Somebody was introduced him to that.
And was enjoying that high together and just left.
It could have been. Mm-hmm. But we have to be more responsible for that. And you know, I'm not going to sit here and say that we should separate, but we have to take back control of our community. We have to do a better job of protecting our women, our children. We have to take that back. We have to. It was a time that we tried to do that, and, you know, we had our thing going on. You know, Tulsa, Oklahoma, they bombed, they tore it up. And that deferred us from doing.
Right. We never went back.
But we are in a position now that we have education. We have some of those who have the financial resources. We have to be able to step up and build and make it better for the next generation, and so on. I mean, we're not going to accomplish it, everything that we need to accomplish.
Let's be real. Racism, greed, and power, that to me, this is how this country was built on those qualities, it ain't going nowhere anytime soon. So like the King was saying, we need to be able to be a lot more independent as a people. Like the Jews are. Like the Mexicans are.
They circulate their money within, you know, and
they use America for their own benefit. We're the only race that's screaming to be accepted on an even basis with the racist part of America, and it's not gonna happen. We're not gonna get our 40 acres and a mule. We're not in this lifetime.
It's crazy you say that. Also in the Pew Research, it says more than 150 years after the 13th Amendment abolished slavery in the United States, most U.S. adults says the legacy of slavery continues to have an impact on the position of black people in American society today.
And I hate when people say, well, that was a long time ago, get over. No, we still dealing with the effects of that, man.
Right.
It's trickled down, you know, it's not as obvious. Yeah, I mean, you know, a lot of us not getting chained, and which, I mean, people still getting drugged, you know, but I mean, it's happening, but it's not
still,
as
you're still
as
getting
much.
Chained and whipped, because yeah. You're getting chained and whipped on what you can do on the job, you're
true.
Getting chained
true.
And whipped,
true.
If you're going to get that position that you're more qualified true. For than the other person, so.
You're getting chained and
yeah,
whipped.
Still getting chained and whipped.
On you. They didn't just trade it in the white sheets for police uniforms.
Right, right.
But, seriously, no, but. I mean, we just have to. It's that old saying that ain't nobody gonna care for you like you do.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, if I'm not willing to get out there and take care of me and mine, anybody else gonna throw me nothing.
True.
You know what I'm saying? You can't sit out there and just beg for this man. You're not making an effort to do nothing. And that's just what it is.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's just, listen, if I came to either one of y'all flat on my butt, and let's just say I had an addiction problem, and I'm coming, man, every week, man, let me borrow this, let me borrow. I would hope that you would see that it's just me running game. And I mean, I know you know it's hard sometimes to do that with people that you love,
mm-hmm.
but I'm not trying to help myself.
Right.
Now, you know, if I come and I be like, hey, man, you know, I know you got a house back there in the back, ain't nobody staying. Won't you let me stay there till I get on my feet? But every time you see me, I'm getting high. I'm getting
right.
Low.
Right.
Now, let's say, flip side, you know, I didn't try to clean myself up, you know. I don't want to find me a job. And you know, some people who work that don't have places to stay.
Right.
And you see, that's something different. That's me trying to help myself. So I'm more willing to help somebody who's doing that.
Right.
But you know, no one wants to just be taken advantage of.
Right.
Well, with that being said, we're going to go ahead and get ready to go to break. And hopefully this time the audio will be working.
I'm still gonna watch what I say.
All right, we now back live here in the upper room. America, we still here. We letting you know we ain't going nowhere. Even though you're trying to get rid of us, we not going anywhere. And if you look in the bottom of the screen, we're running our next show will be January 5th, and that'll be the topic. Within the next couple, in the next coming few days, we will be taking a poll of, I guess you could call it some subtopics that you would like us to speak on and you would want to join in. And we keep trying to get y'all to come on, you know, we started out strong and now we can't get nobody even to join in.
Why they don't call in, Mark? You said it before.
Hey, man, fear. These bright lights. Camera. Action. Hey, you know. You know, it's much more difficult when you can't edit yourself. Whatever
press
comes
rewind,
out.
Huh?
That's it.
Did you ever know that? You ever think about what this? And you go back and look at it. I went back and found that. This is my first time. I've never really watched one of our shows. I went back and looked at it on YouTube after Zeke edited it.
Uh-huh.
Man, we damn good after, you know, it was edited.
After all the editing,
yeah.
After all
the you did a good job. I had to tell me, had, you
polishing
know,
it up,
yeah.
Covering up all the rough edges.
You know, but, so.
Like our studio, with this, she don't like that. She ain't getting no credit. That's what it is.
Oh, is that what it was? Okay,
yeah,
so
yeah.
You're not the one editing.
Nah, actually, I am.
Okay.
She
okay.
Made proofread all the stuff
okay.
In the title.
Okay. Okay, I got you.
I got a question for you two guys, man. Do you think the racism that's directed towards blacks is more so due to lack of respect or a sense of you're beneath me because you were my slave.
I don't think they look at it as, yes, a lack of respect. The slave report, I don't think they think of it like that, but I think they feel they're entitled because of what they may have been told by their parents that, you know, you're more superior than them. You don't have to listen to them. You don't have to respect them. They should respect you. I don't think it'll come out as like, you my slave, but the gesture.
The fact that you used to be a slave to my great-great-great-great-grandfather, do you think the mentality is beneath me?
I think it's fear. I think they fear the actual fact that this could be even playing ground. I mean, we're qualified. Anything that you can do, I can do. You see what I'm saying? So now, you know, we don't want to lose our place out in the hierarchy. So, you know, let me find a way to keep you, keep my foot on your throat.
Which leads me to the MAGA hat. Make America great again. And in my opinion, I feel like that message is more so, the drive to that message is pretty much about the fear of wanting to go back to how things used to be when they had that control.
And what you said, they need to do what? Keep their what?
Put in front of your phone.
Give you a quote. Paul Butler.
Speak it.
The U.S. justice is built to humiliate and oppose black men, and it starts with the chokehold effect by putting your foot on their throat.
So when I posed the question earlier, too, about do y'all think it's lack of respect, I think both of y'all went towards the, how they feel like they should treat us based on what we were. If we don't respect ourselves, how is somebody else going to respect us?
True.
Now, that may not be the case 100% when you're dealing with the races of how they treat blacks, but at the same time, we're not helping our situation either, trying to climb that ladder or get out this hole if we continue to disrespect or don't have respect for ourselves. Case in point, if you think about other ethnic groups going to a bank to get a loan, man, they may not even check your credit. Just the fact you coming in and you're a Middle Eastern, oh, here you go.
Or if you have money.
Well, I'm just saying based on how we have to go through Congress almost to get a loan for a business, and that may be based on the fact that there's no respect for us as a people because of we don't make good business deals, we don't save our money, we're horrible spenders, and you know, but that perception is reality though to a certain degree, Free. It's not really just made up, and it's just leading to what I'm saying is we have to do a better job as a people to demand that respect. Not that the racists are gonna like us, but in order to get up there with the Jews, with the Middle Easterns, with the Chinese, you know, those people, man, I don't think that the races like them either. But when it comes to being respected economically, and hey, man,
I've been telling you, man, with the green trumps any other color out there, man, that's just the way it is, you know. And you think about when we look at certain people and we talking about, we say this, well, they can be doing more for our people. Mm-hmm. And they worry about their money.
Right.
You know?
Right.
It's just what it is. Right. They worrying about their money.
Right.
But
I mean, do we as a people have the confidence to invest in our in ourselves, in our community?
We're just seeing that's the problem. We don't.
Why would we expect them to? Because we don't trust.
I don't trust that if I give you $10,000, you're gonna do the right thing with it, and that's the problem.
Right.
And it's the same when we sit and say, well, let's buy black-owned banks. Well, what happened if something happened? Or are they going to be able to cover my money? That's the first thing that comes through. Listen, for Chase, Morgan, and Wells Fargo to get to where they go, people had to take a chance. They had to step out on faith.
But my thing is, even with them, you talk about Chase, Wells Fargo, these companies was established decades and years ago.
Okay, I understand
But like with the newer companies, like in my honest opinion, I'd be afraid to invest in my own unless it's like a family member or a close friend or a brother. Because my thing is, if I, like you just said, $10,000, how fast is my return going to be? Am I going to have to wait 10 years or 15 years?
But here's the thing, would you take that chance with a Jew, a Jewish person? Would you take that chance with the white person?
But not necessarily legend with a white or Jewish person. If you say a company that I know is well established, I probably take that chance and invest in stocks or invest in that company. Because I know it's already established compared to a company that's just trying to start. I have no idea that it's gonna jump
off. Your return is gonna be very minimal on something like that. And that's the point. With us, we don't want to take chances because we don't want to take a loss. But you just think, if had you 25 years ago taken a chance and invested some money in Amazon, where you would be right now? If you'd been a couple thousand dollars, well, where would you be right now? You wouldn't be sitting here, right?
We don't take chances.
And that's what I'm getting at. And you know, you say that these companies were established years and years ago, but they had to start somewhere.
But
every place, everything has a beginning.
But can you look at the mindset though? Because the reason why other races, you know, especially white people, they can take those chances because they've always had. This country is built on them having that security we've never had. So any little thing that we get, we're going to hold on to it for dear life, whether it's $3,000, $3, and we're not about to take that chance because we lose this, it may be over. Right, so you can't really blame at the same time because of that fear. That's why we're stuck.
Well,
how do we overcome that?
Well, and I say to that, and to everybody else listening, if that's how you feel, then we need to be quiet and just take what you give and what you fit, because that's what it is. You either take it or you do something to change. There's no in between. If you don't like, listen, what he's always say, you walk in the room, you don't like what's going on, you do what you can do to change the room, don't let it change you, or you walk out. You got options. It ain't a whole lot, but you do have options. So, again, it takes us back to not trusting one another. I don't want to trust you, but then at the same time, I want the brother man deal.
Hook him up.
No, man, $40. Let me get that for 40. I don't want to pay the $43.29. And we didn't already talk about that.
Yeah, that still goes on right now.
Yeah, but it does. But you know, when you go buy this nice Gap shirt and you go over there in Macy's, $67.23, home one. That's what you're gonna pay.
With tax.
Yeah, but that's what I'm just gonna say with the tax. So
you don't ask Mr. Guest Man.
Yeah. Because they're gonna tell you to get on about your business.
Right.
You'll come back when it's on sale or when you got enough money.
And they know we're gonna come back because we one of the biggest spenders in the country.
We want to look a certain way. We want to look successful instead of taking a chance on being successful.
That's it. Preach.
So we take the little money that we do have, that we can, don't get me wrong, we can take a loss. But instead of taking that money and putting it into something that can be life changing,
right?
What we do? We go buy the new limited George that came out. That we got to sit right there on the clock and it's counting down till they release.
How about the new iPhone?
And that's what I'm saying.
But I think people are afraid of if you take what you have and you may take a loss. You know, it goes back what the legend said. What if you lost everything? Then how are you going to recoup?
But that's,
that company's okay. Not going to say, well, let me give you this back.
That's the mentality that's been put in us going all the way back from slavery.
What I'm telling you, though, is what's the difference? Because it's a loss anyway. What I take, if I take $2,000, legend come to me and he say, man, I'm trying to start up this. I got the startup business, and you know, and now he's gonna try to sell me, man, it's gonna take off, we're gonna do this, we're gonna do that, you know, 50-50, whatever. I got $2,000. So I'm gonna take that $2,000, and I can either invest him, or what am I gonna do? I'm gonna go buy me some nice, couple nice outfits, couple pair of shoes.
Mm-hmm. Go to the club.
Give me a bottle.
But can they
give me a new one? And now that $2,000 gone, because it don't take much for it to be gone.
Mm-hmm.
It don't take much. So again, what do I have to show for it besides a few clubs?
But
that don't mean nothing.
But not all the time. They may not go spend it. They may have some that do a little bit better. They just put in savings, which ain't really doing anything either.
Right.
And the money not growing.
Well, at least with that, you have it in case you need to
right,
fall
but
back
you talk,
on.
But if we talking about getting wealthy, getting to the level of wealth, you're going to have to take a chance.
Well, let's take a chance.
At some point.
Uh-huh.
But as a people, we got to get past the fear. There's a real mental block in our community about doing stuff like that. But you take the average white person, that fear is non-existent. Again, you have to go back. Why? Why is that? How did that get in us? Where did that originate?
But I don't think all their fear is non-existent. Some of them probably feel the same way as us. Like, I can't afford to invest in this company because I have to do A, B, and C.
Oh, Frank, it's not 100%. I'm
right.
Not saying that, but I'm just
saying the majority.
I'm talking about as a people, as a community.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you're going to have some.
And what he's saying is, when he speaks on them, it's almost like a blanket effect. It's just like when he says them, and of course it's not often, just like when they try to, people say that, you know, we all gang bangers and this and that. It's just
right.
A blanket effect.
Right.
You know, we're going to let it cover everybody.
Right.
But, you know.
I'm going to speak on myself.
No.
I'm going to go ahead and speak on myself. We don't have to judge it with gangbangers and street people, thugs or whatever. I have the fear. And I'm going to go around. Weston talked to me a few times about possibly investing. Sounds good. Everything is just lining up. Guess what? I literally have to deal with the fear of maybe taking maybe a couple of $1,000 out my account that I didn't work hard for, hustle for, and that chance of it not going through. Now I feel like, oh my God, I ain't got nothing. I know I got something, I got backup, but that's an actual fear. I deal with that, for real. Because, I mean, it ain't like I never heard about it before you brought it up, but it was just interesting. Here's my homeboy bringing up stuff about, Murph, man, what about new investments and this and that, and he has some good ideas, and I'm hearing it, man. I'm like, yeah. And after I get off the phone, I write it down, but that fear inside of me just kind of go a different way.
Because you don't know the outcome, maybe.
I don't know what the outcome, and it's just...
So it goes back from what the king said. It can be a big outcome, it could be a good outcome.
It can be, you know...
But I'm never going to get past this level where I'm at unless I take a leap of faith, take that step, and just be like...
I'll tell you what we'll do. When we go to break, you turn around and fall back in our kitchen. That'll help you.
I don't know if we want to do that illustration. I think for a laugh,
you have
to let me go.
So you're thinking about the high school.
Even till this day, I think that'll be just a good laugh. The Ravens are going through the roof.
Well, that's what we're trying to do.
Oh, okay.
That's for the bigger picture. Mm-hmm. But But no, seriously, man, and that's something that we really do need to sit down. And let me tell you something. People always think to invest in something, it has to be this ungodly amount of money. Now, you get people, man, that can... You got children that are becoming millionaires over mixing up nail polishes and all kinds of stuff.
Little small inventions.
You know, so... the Lakers won again, too, man. I mean, they just doing that. But anyway, you know, so, I mean, it is all about sitting down, taking the chance. It don't have to be an ungodly amount of money. You know, you're going to take a couple of $100 and, you know, you find the right thing to invest in, you can make it right. You might not become, you know, the next Bill Gates, but you can be comfortable from it. But it takes getting over that fear. Yeah. The fear of losing.
Yeah.
That's what it is. It's the fear of losing.
Losing stuff that, because we've never had.
Right.
The fact that you've never had it, you don't want to lose it.
Or if you have that little piece of change or money saved up, like you said, you don't want to lose that. Because once you're invested in it, like myself, I want to see what the quick return going to be. I don't want to have to wait 4 years, 5 years, 6 years, or whatever the case may be, mm-hmm. especially if I'm investing a large amount of money. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, like $1,000 is a lot of money to me, but if I have to invest in that, and I may give it a year in return, but I'm not getting nothing off of my $1,000 a year
return. You're
going
to get anxious. Like, you're going to get anxious.
Like, it's a bad investment. But
it's really not. But it's really not, though.
Yeah.
It's really not.
It may be.
No, because
we don't know.
If you're not getting nothing back, as long as you haven't lost it,
it's not a bad investment.
You gotta ride it. You gotta ride that wave, man. But again, it goes back to fear. Mm-hmm. You know?
Man, it's just something that we gonna have to learn to do, man. And they got all kind of little apps and stuff that's popping up on your phone now. You look at them, you learn to invest. And it's I've been trying to think of this book that I picked up a while ago, and as a matter of fact, several years ago, and when we moved, it disappeared somewhere. So now I'm gonna buy it again. I'm gonna have to look it up, but it speaks on that, you know, about being broke and being afraid, basically, to do what you need to do to get out of that situation. Mm-hmm. You know, and sometimes you have to take a step back. Take a couple of steps forward.
Yep.
But again, you know, we get comfortable. You know, I got a car, I got a roof, I got something to eat. You know, my children need, they got shoes. My wife can go buy her a nice dress. You know, we can go out, have a couple of drinks, go to movies, whatever. We get content with that.
But don't want to invest.
But that's.
But my thing is, what happens if, you know, somebody loses their job, somebody gets hurt.
We don't think that far, man.
And then, so,
I mean,
just being comfortable, how much being comfortable is going to take care of that? So,
you got to look at, though, the goal for a lot of people in our community may be just to get a decent job so I can buy a house and then be able to provide my family. That could be the ultimate goal. Whereas for people in other group, other races, that's just like the given. Mm-hmm. You see what I'm saying? Like, that's just like, oh, that's an expectation of, oh, that's the minimum. You're going to graduate from high school, college, and get your job. That's no big deal. They're trying for wealth. Whereas we as a people may be just trying to basically get a good job. And so once we get there, now all of a sudden, okay, well, hey, man, I made it. I'm not about to take another step, man. It took me a while just to get to this point. I got to hold on to everything I got, man. I got bills, man. I can't be taking that chance, Wes, man, blah, blah, blah.
And that's what you hear. That's the conversation you hear. That's the exact conversation that you hear.
Instead of taking a leap of faith.
So that's why we are stuck, so to speak. And, you know, another thing, too, now going beyond that, is that it kind of, six eggs in one hand, half a dozen in the other, you know, you see someone who is of our skin color, and they made that leap. Mm-hmm. 9 times out of 10, they don't want to help you. You know, I'm not gonna give you the my secret recipe, but it's a flip side to that, because we always want them to take us where they at, and we don't want to go through the hard work, the trials and the tribulations and the hardships that they went through to get to where they at.
As my mother's always say, each one teach one.
But a lot of people don't want it. They just want, I just want the benefits, man. Let me get a Maserati and a Mercedes and a house.
They don't want to go through the process.
Exactly. The process.
They don't want to be patient enough to go through the struggles, the process, the hard work that it takes to get to that level.
Let me ask y'all something, man. We're really off subject. I mean, way off subject.
No, go ahead, bro.
What you think about we put the TV in here? So we could be, you know, kind of watching the games right now.
Were you right up there? Was it like a little 20-some inch?
Maybe we could. Yeah, level 32-inch TV.
The problem with that is that Mrs. Brown over there especially going to be getting on me because I'm going to be like this.
Oh, okay.
But my thing is, Legend, when did the ring of the Lakers winning? You wanted to see the outcome?
Well, I just been thinking about that, man. You know my Steelers on.
What's feeling good these days? Because the Steelers been at the bottom for a long time this season.
Oh, yeah, but this season. Okay.
So, you know, man. Lakers out on top. Now we're going to put a TV in here and force me to watch that.
That's what this is all about.
Because you're a Laker fan. You ain't going to be offended by it.
No, I'm a Laker fan. I'm a Chicago Bears fan. No, I'm a Denver Broncos fan.
We don't even got enough time for you to run off our team.
More teams than the people that we get.
I don't care what these guys are saying, man. We would love for y'all to call in and hear y'all views, y'all opinion on the subject that we're talking about. Don't be afraid. We're not going to beat you up. The Legend may get a little offended, and he may tear into you, but me and the King, we here for you.
Man, and another thing is, well, before we get ready to wrap this thing up, you see that we are supposed to when the next show would be the topic, something that we never done before, giving you to you beforehand. But like I say, man, we want y'all to be a part of the show. And I think from time to time we're going to do that. Zeke will be putting up some polls for you to vote on. And I just seen Kev. KD just logged in, man. We want to give a shout out. We want to give a shout out to him.
Shout out, Cleve.
And to especially to his son. They stayed bound.
That's little Cam Newton.
Yeah, we hoping that they pull it out this time. They run up last year, man. But that's still something, man.
Friday, huh? They play Friday.
I beat us.
I'll be there too.
Friday at 7:00. Oh, yeah.
It's gonna be on TV though.
Yeah.
We'll have to catch it on TV.
Yeah, so we definitely want to, you know, give them a shout out and root for them and cheer them on. But with that being said, man, let me get some closing thoughts.
Hey, we go through a lot of things throughout society as African Americans and as minorities. But the bang thing of it all, we have to keep our head up, keep pushing, keep supporting one another. I know that's one of the biggest things and hardest things in the community for us to interact with one another, help one another. Especially when somebody's going through some hard times, you know, even though you may be going through hard times as well, you never know what somebody else may be going through.
I'm pretty much going to piggyback off the Freak, man. You know, there's so much going on that's out of our hands, that's out of our control. And, you know, basically, man, you know, we need to just focus individually on ourselves. And then once we get ourselves right, then we can get our families right and then build a community that way. In my opinion, that's the only way that we're going to turn this thing around. We have to begin to start living our lives without fear. You know, fear is really keeping us stuck in a place to where we can't achieve, we can't become wealthy, we can't become successful. And we have to get past that. In my opinion, that is a generational curse, and we have to get past that.
I would go even a step further than a generational curse. It's just kind of been almost intertwined in our DNA now. You know, you get to riding. I mean, you see a policeman, you know, turn the music down, do this, do that, do that, you know. But, and that's just how we are. We constantly looking.
Paranoid.
Yeah. It's fear, you know, and we just spoke, you know, when we first came on about, you know, the fear with the kidnapping and the sex trafficking, and you know, that's a fear that you can't control. I mean, you know, but the fear of taking a loss because we know we're trying to invest, and that's something.
Yeah.
That we have to get out of it.
We have to overcome.
Yeah, we have to overcome. We have to do a better job than what we are doing. With that being said, man, we got some people that we want to recognize.
Listen, you have that card over there.
I
don't want to forget this young man. Hey, but before we start. Recognizing all our supporters, man. We would really like for y'all to call in. I was talking to this young man yesterday. He's born on the island and BHS alumni, Mr. Broderick James. He have his own company, UNLT Novelties. He makes shirts, hoodies, and stuff like that. But I was speaking to him yesterday. I wanted to give him a shout out. Hey, man, we give you all a platform to be able to call into our show, video chat with us. You know, you have all these other shows that a lot of people would like to call into and don't never get the opportunity. And here we're giving you the opportunity to do that. And we would like to hear from you all. Maybe we probably need to come up with a segment to have, you know, call in and speak your mind. And we can just go off of what they may have to offer.
True.
But with that being said, man, I want to give a big shout out to all our sponsors, Artifact Films, Bench Bullying, Busy Bee, DiverseCity Reality, Era Vintage, Element 7 Salon, Fourtrephotography, that's my son, I love you. Ground Zero Blog Works, Hemp Works, it's not weed, but it's close. Kitty Campus Daycare, Jacquez Chicken and Waffles, that's one of our podcast locations. The next time we're doing a podcast there, we'll definitely let y'all know. LC and the 30th Street Jazz Band, that's the legend and his father's little band crew.
They be jamming.
Maduro's Cigar Lounge, that's another one of our podcast location. Big shout out to Mr. Fred. He had a Christmas party there last night. We had a good time there. Meek and Zeke, that's me and my wife's me and my wife's YouTube channel. Also on Instagram and Facebook. National Scouting Service, Pat Wild Wings, Pack Tech, Picture Perfect Photography. That's that's my cousin Jamisha Hardeman's photography company. Big shout out to her. Tommy Napoli Health and Nutritional Chef, Tourist Player Association. Sea Grant Enterprise and Unveiled Aspiration.
You want to tell them about?
Oh, and also, if you want to broadcast your company throughout our podcast show, please email us at theupperroom409@gmail.com. We'll go over the price with you about broadcasting and advertising your company or whatever you're doing throughout our show.
Shout out to my son Lando. He went to the 5th round in the spelling bee on Friday. So I'm proud of you, son. Good job.
And before we go, we lost a friend of ours, Mr. Willie Holmes, man. I found out through one of our friends, John Florence, that he had passed away. He had kidney failure. Prayers go out to. I never found that out last night.
Willie,
prayers.
Yeah. Away with 88?
Yeah.
That's what it was. Kidney failure.
Yeah. So. Big shout out to his family, man. Y'all in our prayers. Sorry to hear that. And another thing, we have a lot of our followers on Facebook on y'all birthdays, man. We be trying to reply to y'all birthday, telling y'all happy birthday. If we don't get to you, we apologize. So we telling everybody throughout the month of December and into January when our next show, which will be on January the 5th, do you really know your partner? Happy birthday.
You know, all deaths are bad, man. It really don't matter how old they are, if you're your friend or what group. But you know, I was thinking about our class of 91. Have we suffered any deaths from 91?
I don't know any of
them
recently.
In our world of classmates and friends, you know what I'm saying? You know what, in our world, I'm not talking about all 435 people, but I don't know if, you know, class of 92 got been hit, man.
I'm pretty sure we have. We just probably haven't heard of it.
Well, no, I think he's saying that people that we kind of
associate with, that's within the reach of us being able to get in touch with them.
You know, that was always my thing about not going to a class reunion. I like see and talk to the people that I want to see and talk to. So,
and I guess what made me think about that, Biggs that came to mind.
I know.
But, and then I ended up just thinking about that class in 92, man. That class has suffered a lot, but then it made me like, I don't know why, but I was like, man, 91, we haven't suffered. It's not like we were special or anything, but yeah. I guess when I think about, you know, those guys from the class of 92, because we all tight with 92, man, yeah. You know, from the things that they suffered. But anyway, I just thought I'd bring that up. I didn't know if maybe that got by me, that maybe someone had passed.
Okay. Well, like I said, we definitely want to keep his family in prayers and thoughts. And with that being said, January 5th, we will be back.
Do you really know your partner?
Yeah. Oh, we coming home.
Yeah, we gonna have some guests for you too.
We bringing.
You know, normally, you know, when we have the guests, that's when it really get. You really get going, but
And before we go, it has been talks, people. I'm telling you all, y'all need to start tuning into our show as much as you can. We need to hear from you. You need to log on to Stationhead app, because there's a strong possibility you all may start getting these shows when they upload it on YouTube and you don't get to see us live.
Yeah, that is a possibility, and that's some things that, you know, we've been kind of bouncing around and discussing, you know, different views on things. So, but of course, we'll let you know before we go that route. But anyway, with that being said, man, that's the show. God bless.
We out.